seen that confident interval be nothing but a range of values for which our, so say the confident interval will be this range of values from this guy to this guy. So this will be the confident interval, and this is minus x star in general and x star. So x star are the critical values, and this green part is my confident interval. This confident interval comes with a confidence level called 1 minus alpha. Every confident interval comes with a confidence level. The confidence level is 1 minus alpha. So, and this guy is always alpha over 2 and alpha over 2. Few things we need to note here is what we call the confidence level equals 1 minus alpha. It has nothing to do with the confidence interval. For the unknown parameter theta in general is given by the lower bound is always the estimator of this parameter theta. So this is in general. So the estimator of the parameter theta, and then minus the critical value, which I denote here by x star. Okay, critical value is my x star. And then I multiply it by what we call the standard error. So multiply it by the standard error, which is the values, whatever it must be. So let's put SE. SE is the standard error. And then we have theta that, theta hat plus the critical value, and then multiplied by the standard error. So if you are in normal case, the standard error for the mean will be for x bar will be sigma over n, for over root n, and so on and so forth, right? So this standard error depends on the parameter we are considering. It will change accordingly. Okay. So in general, this is the confidence interval for any given unknown parameter theta. Theta was the mean of the population, which is mu. In this particular case, we have the following: if theta equals mu, then the confidence interval for mu is x bar, okay, the estimate of mu is x bar, minus the z alpha, again, and we have to specify what we mean by this according to the scenarios, root n and then x bar plus z alpha over 2 sigma over root n. So you see, once we know the parameter theta, then we know the exact confident interval. Which is not the general case. And then we have seen last time that this case, we have three cases, or three, remember our diagram. So sigma is unknown, yes or no, and n is bigger than 30, yes or no. Remember three. So I'm giving this, but we have three cases, right? I'm giving this, but we have three cases. In fact, what are those three cases? This confident interval boils down to still something. Sigma unknown, yes, we go here, no, we go here. And yes, if yes, then we use this one. Let me call it one. If yes, we use one. Okay. If yes, we go with one. If no, I will write two, and I will write what is two. So, in two, if no, then we check. If n is bigger than 30, then we have a yes and we have a no. Yes and then no. Yes and no will lead you to 3 and then 4. What is 3 and 4? So,
actually, 4 is 1.
4 is 1? 4 is 1 with something. So we write this. I will write, okay, just take it down a little notation for t, so it is f alpha over 2 and then minus 1. This notation is correct. The second notation also is t alpha over 2 brackets n minus 1. This notation is also correct. And then here we have s over root n, and then x bar plus t alpha over 2, right? And then n minus 1. This, both notations are correct. N minus 1 s divided by root n. So I will denote this by 3. This is the thing. So we use 1, 4, or 3 depending on this diagram. Sigma is unknown, yes, we use 1. Sigma is known, yes, we use 1. Sigma is unknown, no, we check again. Is n bigger than 3, the sample size? Yes, we use 4, which is that one. And if no, then we use 3, which is the t distribution. So that's a simple diagram we can remember. Okay? So follow me, there's not only one value, always check your diagram. Okay? So in summary, that's what we need for the mean. And we can do the same thing for the proportion. Of course, we have calculator for the proportion. The only thing that is changing in the proportion is the variance. The variance will be p times 1 minus p. That's the only thing that will be changing for the variance, for the proportion. So we have a confident interval for the proportion, and we have a confident interval for the variance as well. So remember this, and example we did last time was this one. Okay? He said we just gave the answer without the detail of it. You are right. Let's now understand the difference. Okay, so here we go. We have two candidates. A and B are running for an office. And a pool is conducted and 1,000 voters are selected and are asked for their preference. 52 are supporting A and 48 are supporting B. We want to find a confident interval at a confident level of 95% for each of them. So we get the answer without going to the details, but then this is indeed a proportion. So because we have a proportion, out of 1,000 voters, 52 are in favor of A, so therefore it becomes a proportion where P hat, lowercase p hat, 4a. Okay. So 4a, we have this information. Lowercase p hat is 52%. And n is 1,000. Right? So for this confidence interval, we have a proportion, and if we go back to the confidence interval for the proportion is just right here. alpha over 2 because n is bigger than 30. Remember here, n is bigger than 30. Okay. N is bigger than 30, then we use z alpha over 2, and this is the variance of the this. So we have to look at, we have to try and find all these informations. P hat is known, that's 52%. N is known, it's 1,000. Z alpha over 2 is Z 5% divided by 2, which is Z 0.025, which is by looking at the table 1.96. Okay. P hat is known, everything is known, we just go ahead and plug in the value. Okay? So 1 minus P also, we have to try to figure out that, and this will be 48%. So all the information I know, we just plug in. Okay? Plug in, yes. Nothing to do. If you plug in, you will get this guy, you will get 0.52, and that's what I wrote, because they just plug it in. 0.52, which is P hat, minus now you write 1.96, which is the critical value, times root P hat, which is 0.52, times 1 minus P hat, which is 0.48, divided by 1,000. This is the low bound. You do the same thing for the upper bound, which is 0.52, and then plus 1.96, root all of that. And we close the bracket. Okay. And that's what gives you the result I wrote before, which is this one, which is this one for A. We do the same thing for B. That's 48 is changing. And then we have an answer. So that's how you do it. Any question? Any question about this computation? So you take all the information you need. P hat is given 52%. N is given, and N is bigger than 30, so therefore we have to use this one. P here and 1 minus P, they are unknown, so you bring them by the estimator. So it's displayed by P hat. And then after finding everything, we just plug in. So 0.52, which is my P hat, minus this critical value, which is 1.96, looking at the normal table, and then the square root of whatever is inside, replace it, and finally we will get the first 1.48. Make sense, anybody? Any question? So P is unknown. Do you know P? We don't. P is a true proportion. So whenever something's unknown, we replace it by its estimator. Its estimate in this case. So that's why we replace P by its estimates. Its estimate. Okay. So P is unknown because P is a true value. Therefore, we have to put here P hat. We have to put here P hat, P hat, P hat, P hat. Because we are dealing with an estimate now. Okay. So P hat, P hat, P hat, P hat everywhere. And then we know P hat, then we plug it. Make sense? Because the true value, the true proportion is never known in practice. It's never known. Therefore, we have to use its estimate in this case. Okay? Make sense? Good. So we have the answer corrected. Now, there is something called the sample size. As we have seen, in these calculations, the sample size is involved, right? The error. The sample size. The sample size error. What do we know about the example, the sample size? The error E, the error denoted by E, we commit by estimating mu the sample mean, X bar is smaller than delta alpha over 2, sigma over root 2. It's smaller than this with probability. So this error, whenever we are estimating something by something, we are doing some error inside, because that's an estimation. Yes?
I was going to ask, if you, in the last question, replace n to be less than 3, would it just replace it t alpha over 2?
Yes.
Is that the only difference?
Yeah. So whenever we are doing an estimation, we are making an error. Trying to get the closest value to the true value. But we never get to have a true value, right? Because it's unknown. So we're making some mistake by considering an estimate. And the mistake we're doing is called an error. That error, sometimes we want to know how big or how small is that error. Are we doing good? Are we doing good? Or are we doing really bad? It's all related to the estimate, the error that you're making. If you're making a lot of mistake, a lot of error, then your confidence level might be really poor, very poor confidence level. And we want to always sometimes minimize this error. And minimizing the error is related to the sample size. That's why the title is sample size. So there is a link between the error and this quantity, and that's what we have to figure out, right? The bigger, and yes.
Is that why in the last question you have the p estimator minus that standard error?
Yes, if you want, yeah, somehow. So it's p estimator minus something times the standard error. Okay, it's in there, because that's the same question we have here. Okay, so we want to minimize this error we are making, because too much error might lead to something really useless. Right. So say, for example, okay, I am 95% confident that Mustafa will be, Mustafa being in this class, the confidence interval for that is 1 to 95. It's 1 to 95. 1 to 95 confidence interval that Mustafa will be in this room. So I'm almost certain, almost sure. And there is no way that I cannot find Mustafa here, because this is 1 to 95, and only 5% mistake I'm doing. Okay, so most of the time I'm going to find Mustafa because my interval is too wide. And you give us an idea? It's wide. So, almost 100% I find Mustafa here. But say if I say my interval is 1.5 and 1.6, very narrow. Right? Now it's difficult to find Mustafa. And this is all related to the error I'm doing. How big is my n? Okay, it's interesting, because those who are doing statistics in companies, this thing would be helpful. Maybe we could ask for that hypothesis test, which we are going to do in a second. And you've been asked to provide a confidence interval and to interpret your confidence interval and see how meaningful is your confidence interval. If you don't know these things today we are doing, well, you are just done. You know what? You're just gone. Your boss will be asking, well, what do you mean by this? What is my confidence about? Do you mean that? I don't know. I've done nothing about relating to, I've done nothing related to statistics. So tell me, give me something. Explain what it means for me, this confidence about. You have to come up with an explanation. That's the support you have to understand. Because in the company, they are using this. And you'll be asked to interpret these results to those who are not statisticians. You cannot just come and say, I have a 95 confidence about, and here it is, that's it. Well, what? What it is? Okay. You know what I mean? This is very, very useful. It's extremely important. Extremely important. Okay, now let's move on. Yes, question. So let's try to visualize what's going on right here through this line. Okay? So whatever we do, most probably you'll be doing those of you working with one of them would like to further their studies. They might be doing these things later on, so. Unless if you just hate statistics and you don't want to do anything about it, say after you have passed the class, then that's another story, right? Then I would have to come and see you and say, well, I did this class, but I was expecting you to further your study with statistics, you know? And to try to go and say, you know what, my teacher was explaining these things. At that time, I had no clue about what's going on. But today, yes, I'm seeing how useful are these things. And usually the student, they write to the professor and say, you know what, thank you, because I'm now seeing the importance of what I have learned 5 years ago. Right? So, yeah, they do have it, something to do with your real life. Okay, and this is my X bar. And this guy from here all the way to here is the length of my interval, which is 2 z alpha over 2 sigma root n. That's the length of my interval. So this is the lower bound, this is the upper bound, and this is my estimate, my estimator, which is, and this whole thing is just mu. Mu is somewhere in between. This is the 2 parameter I'm trying to estimate, and that's the confidence interval I have found for this estimate, for this unknown parameter, and that's the length of my interval. Right? That's the length of my interval. So if you control, if you want to control the error, then we have to control sample size. Okay? If you want to control the error, we have to control the sample size n. Okay? And we want the sample size, the error, and the sample size to have this relation. So when the error to be bigger than z alpha over 2 sigma root n. We want the error to be bigger than this. This means that my sample size will be bigger than z alpha over 2 times sigma divided by the error all to the power 2. So that's the relationship we are looking for. We want the error to be bigger than. To control the error, you have to control the sample size, and this is the relationship we have. So the error must not be bigger than this value, must be bigger than this value, the sample size, to have something meaningful. Example. Example. Let sample S1 up Xn is selected from normal population with sigma equals 100. With a standard deviation equal to 100. What sample size should be used to ensure that the error on the population estimate, at most 10. So we want to control our error to be at most 10. Based on this condition we have set before, we want to know which sample size we have to use. How big should be our sample? So I want to say, I want to know how many students I have to consider in my sample so that the error I will make will not be more than 10. What I mean? So I'm looking for n. Do I need 3 people? Do I need 4 students? Do I need 5 students? I'm looking for my n. How many students do I need to select to conduct my analysis to be almost sure that I will not exceed an error of 10? I'm looking for my n. And we use the same condition as before, right? N must not be bigger than n, must be bigger than this guy divided by the error of all squares. So you just compute this, and this will be the error you'll be making. So be careful. Okay, the error n is an integer, right? So here we have then n must satisfy the following. N is bigger than Z alpha over 2 times sigma divided by the error whole squared, which is Z alpha over 2. And, okay, the alpha is, I forgot the alpha. Alpha is given to be 0.05. Okay? Alpha, we have alpha here. So alpha must be given because we have Z alpha to find, sorry. So here, alpha is given and is equal to 0.05. So with 0.05, and we know that we have a normal, so Z, great. No, not 2.5. 2.5 was, 2.5% squared, which is Z of 2.5%, which is, this is already the case for normal distribution. Normal distribution of 2.5% is always 1.96, so you don't even need to look at it. That's always the case, right? But that's 1.96, and sigma is given is 100. Sigma is 100, and the error is 10. So putting everything inside, it gives me the following. It gives me 19.6 squared, which is, so we want our n to be bigger than 384.15. What should be my n? What should be the minimum value of my n? 385. Thank you. Because n is an integer. Okay, so we take the greatest integer right after that. 85. What if I had 0001? Sorry for the Yes, so it's 1.25, I'm 100% sure. Don't try to make me to doubt my solution. Okay, we would, I would here. No, I wouldn't. Yes, I would here. Okay, so n must be 385. Okay. Okay, so that's how you evaluate the error. So always try to look at the greatest value. To be more strict, we can even put bigger strictly than this, to be even more strict. So we can put strictly bigger than this one, because we always take the value that is above the number that is here. Okay? So that's how you do this one. And yes.
But if you got like exactly 384, it would be something 388.
Yes, if you use this one, it must be always the value bigger than this one, strictly. But yes, correctly, that it should be strictly, because when the error is strictly bigger than, therefore this has to be strict. And if it is strict, even if we got when you've got 384 exactly, we have to take the number of that, because we are strictly bigger than that number. It must be always the next number, because it's strictly bigger than that number. Okay, so there is something called the confidence interval. I will do that later. So it's called the confidence interval for the variance. I will keep that for hypothesis testing. I think we can now go with hypothesis testing today. Okay, we are done. Okay, we're almost done. The only thing that is left is the confidence interval for the variance, and I will do that when doing the hypothesis testing. Confidence interval for C. The confidence interval for sigma, that's something is related. So in order to do the confidence interval for an unknown parameter, we have to know the distribution of that parameter, or the distribution related to the estimator of that parameter. We already know that. I can go away, but because we have derived the estimator, we know that n minus 1 divided by sigma squared over s squared has the chi-squared distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. So I know that this guy follows a chi-squared distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Therefore, I can go ahead and construct my confidence interval for sigma, for the variance, right? So how do we do it? Confidence interval for sigma, right? Confidence interval for sigma. Let me just recall something. Let me go back and recall something quickly. I think it was something distribution toward the end. Toward the end, we talked about point estimation of the variance. Distribution is chi-squared distribution. Okay, so we have the chi-squared distribution, which is right here. So we can also do the confidence interval for the difference of the samples. Okay, just give me 1 second. example, we did all this. So as I said, we will come back to this, the variance, but it all comes from this guy, right? The idea, I will just write the idea, but I will not continue it now. The idea is to write 1 minus alpha equal to probability that this guy is between x star, which is the lowercase, the critical value. So let me call it chi square 1 minus alpha, 1 minus alpha over 2. Or let me just call it x star. X star minus x star. X star, don't write this, I'm just explaining you the idea. X star star between n minus 1 x squared divided by sigma, and we have x star 2. So the confident interval will come when we just have to isolate the sigma squared. So we invert everything, so we have, if we invert everything, so we have 1 over x2 must be less than the sigma squared divided by n minus 1 x squared, and this must be less than s1, 1 by s1. And then we try to isolate our sigma squared to get the confident interval for sigma squared. But as I said, we will do something different. More important than this, which is the difference of two means and the difference of the pooled difference. The pooled difference. These are most important than this. I will come back to this when doing the calculation. But this is the idea how to consider the confident interval, okay? You don't need to write it because we will come back to this. You don't need to write it down. Okay? So, confident interval for the difference of two means. For the difference of two means. Okay? Now let's consider CDR means consider 2RID random 2RID samples. Let's consider 2RID samples. We have the sample X1 up to XN, and we have two things related to this sample. We have the mean is denoted by mean of xi, and we have its variance, which is called sigma x squared. And for the second sample as well, which is y1 up to yn, we have two things. Mu y and sigma y squared. So mu y and sigma y are the mean and variance of the sample y, and mu x sigma x are the mean and variance of the sample x. Okay? Now, how do we compare the means? The question we have to ask ourselves, how do we want to look at the behavior of these two guys. So as I said, we have two groups. I want to compare or I want to find the confidence interval related to the difference of the means. Later on, when doing hypothesis, I want to see which one is higher, which one has a greater value as compared to as far as the mean of the midterm one, for example, is concerned, online and in person. Right? Sometimes there is a big difference between the two, like I told you last time. I'm taking statistics transfer, and we have a group online, and four groups in person. And one of my group, which is the section I'm teaching currently, they have 75% as an average. And one group in person, they have 53%. So the difference is very huge. It's a lot. What could explain that? Many things. So hypothesis will be related to, and we'll discuss about this, how is mu1 related to mu2? Both classes, do they have the same average? Or versus H1, is the mean of the first one bigger than the mean of the second one? Right? Or vice versa. Is the mean of the first one less than the mean of the second one? And so on and so forth. Or they are just different. So if I say they are just different, I'm not interested in which one is bigger. I just want to know they are not the same. So this is called hypothesis testing, and this is what we do right after this one. It's interesting because it gives you an idea of what's going on between two groups. Okay. So we'll get to that, but this is just an introduction of what's coming. You don't need to write it again. Okay. So we want to compare the two meanings, right? To do so, we need something called the pooled or also set common variables. So for the common variance, we have to compute SP. SP is given by, so this sample size is M, sorry for that. This is M and this is N. Okay? So we have M minus 1, M minus 1. SX squared plus N minus 1 SY squared divided by M plus N minus 2. This is called the pooled variance. Okay, the pooled variance. So, having this, then the 100, 1 minus alpha percent confidence interval for the difference of these two guys, mu x minus mu y, is given by the following. If, so again, if is trying to find a way to write it as a tree. If M plus N minus 2 is bigger than 30, then we have this one or this one. Yes, we have this one. No, we have this one. So no, we have this one. We have x bar minus y bar plus or minus. So I will use the notation plus or minus. It means the same thing. Okay? Yes, Mustafa, I'm coming. Times SP root of 1 over M plus 1 over N. So if it is no, we use the T distribution. If it is no, we use the T distribution, and with M plus N minus 2 degrees of freedom. And if it is yes, we use the second one. So I will write it down. I will write it below. If it is yes, we use the second one. If it is yes, we use the same thing, but with T replaced by Z. Use the same thing with T replaced by Z. Plus or minus Z alpha over 2. Okay? So, is M plus 2, M plus N minus 2 bigger than 30? Yes. Okay, we use this one. No, we use that one. Okay? Yes.
Above, was it S of Y, and then all that square?
is it S squared of Y? Y is just a notation, right? To say that it's coming from the sample Y. So it's S squared of Y. S squared times substitute Y. Okay? So the confidence interval for the difference of these two means X mu X minus mu Y is given by this. So it's X bar minus Y bar plus or minus the second part. Or it's X bar plus Y bar plus or minus C Z alpha over 2, and you do the same thing. Now let's do an example. Right? Example, student grades. In the four websites screen. So we have X represent students during the fall session and Y during the spring session. So here M equals 6, N equals 8. Student here. And students here. So X bar is given by 74, Y bar is given by 60, SX is given by 11, and SY is given by 9. So what? The 95 confidence interval, what is 95 confidence interval for difference of mean, for difference of mean. So number one, since m plus n minus 2 equals 6 plus 8 minus 2, which is what? 12, which is less than 30, therefore we use the second one. So we use this one. We use this one. And to use this one, we need few information. X bar is given, Y bar is given, S, we need to find SP, so SP is given by M minus 1 SX squared plus N minus 1 SY squared divided by M plus N minus this squared. So doing that, we get, you have to find this. Once you have this, you have the X bar, you have the Y bar, you need to find the T distribution, so you need to find a T005 divided by 2. So you need to find a T0025 using the T table. T0025 using the T table. Again, I don't have a T table with me, unfortunately I didn't print it. So we'll next lecture, which is I will have a T table with me, and I will have the chi square table with me, and I will show you how to read them. Yes? What
do you think?
Yes.
What is that?
The bottom, the standard deviation. SY is the standard deviation of X, and SY is the standard deviation of the sample Y. And SX is a standard deviation, sample standard deviation. This is sample standard deviation of X. And SY is the sample standard deviation of Y. So here we have sample standard deviation square of X. So we have the square 11. And SY square, we have the square 9. And then everything is plugged in. You just need to read the T 0.025 from the table with M plus 1 minus 2 degrees of freedom. So this is 12 degrees of freedom, right? That's 12 degrees of freedom. So again, as I said, I will just leave it like that because everything is known except I just need to compute SP, which is easy. I just plug in. I just need to read this from the teacher, and I have to show you that how to read it. So we leave this example like that. Next week, I will show you. Once I will show you how to read from T table, how to read from Z table, from chi square table, then we'll come back to this example.
It's 2.179.
You have it, Omar?
Yeah.
Good. So that's. We'll check that later on because I need to have a table with me.
2.179.
Okay, I trust you. And we'll confirm that next week. So this is the value we got. 2.179, we plug in and just come. The computation is left to you. Okay? You know, everything here is known. We just go ahead and compute.
SX and SY.
Yes. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. These two guys. They're here. Sometimes I'm going to give you, or sometimes I'm going to give you just a data, raw data. So 2.9, 2.5, 2.6, 2.10. And with that, for x, you have to find the mean of x bar by just operating that. You have to find the sample variance by just using the formula. And I will give you two samples, x and y. Then you have to find all these values, mean of x, mean of y, variance of y, and sample size of x, sample size of y, and we do all the work. Yes, he had a question before me. Yes?
Shouldn't it be SP squared?
Yes. You are right. That's very true. This would be SP squared. Did I use SP again? Yes, that's SP squared. Very well. Very good. And that's the reason why SP is taken out from the square. Because we had the square. So this is SP squared. Which is going to be far when you have the square root of that. Thank you. Yes?
That's a question.
What? Wonderful. Any question? Any question? Any question? No. No question. So what is the time? 9:30. We started at 8:30. We have about 20 minutes left. Okay, so we'll be able at least to finish. I want you to start hypothesis testing, but you won't be able. Anyhow, let's for two proportions, we have the same thing. So this is the difference of two proportions, okay, like the proportion sample, the two candidates A and B. This was two proportions, so we can find the confidence interval of their difference. Okay. So you see, we have the same condition as well. Let me just pick this graph here. We have the same thing here. So these. Just copy this and paste it away. For the proportion, we have the same result. So the confidence interval for the proportion of two samples, we call it P1 minus P2 or PX minus P2. Same thing, notice P1 minus P2 is given by, if this is true, you have the same condition here. No, we have that one, so this, no, this is removed. This is removed, this is removed, this is removed. So we have the following. It will be equal to P1, which is the first sample, minus P2, which is the second sample, plus or minus Z alpha, no, T alpha over 2 M plus N minus 2 times one is 1 minus P1 half. Okay? And Q2 is 1 minus P2 half. Right? So for the proportion, we have the same condition. If it is no, then P1 minus P2 T alpha over 2 N plus 1, N plus N minus 2. P1 Q1 over N plus PT Q2, P2 Q2 over M. And Q, Q1 is 1 minus P1, and Q2 is 1 minus Q2. And if it is yes, we have the same thing. So it would be P1 minus P2 plus or minus Z alpha over 2 and square root of P1 Q1 hat over N plus P2 Q2 hat over M. Okay, and that's true for the proportion. So we have the same confidential value for the difference of two proportions. And we have one more thing to discuss about, and we are done for this section. We are definitely done for this section. Okay. In this case, we suppose that X and Y are had before and after and intervention could you please take a piece of paper, write down the name of those who are present. Can you just do that for me? One piece of paper, just separate it among you. Don't write those who are not. I will call it at the end of the class. I know you guys are very smart. You put the name of your friends. Don't. Could you just take a piece of paper from you? Write down your name and number and just give it to me at the end of the day. Those who attend the class will have good news. Maybe at the end of the class. Maybe later on. Those who are not. It's on them, right? Don't mind their name. I don't know, maybe not. I don't know. I will see. We'll see. If you work hard, you'll pass the class. If you don't, maybe you'll fail. Okay? So let's continue. Okay? So suppose X and Y are the before and after intervention on the same question. The same person, so maybe they have a relationship between them. They are not independent anymore because they're the same person. Okay? For instance, let's denote Xi to be the test score for person I. And Yi is the same thing, the test score for the same person I in spring. Okay? So since they are all related to each other, it's the same person, so these random variables, xi's and yi's, they are related because it's the same person. Now, in that case, we don't do the difference of these. We want to study the difference of the two means. We have to be careful. We don't use the confidence interval that we did for the difference of the two means. Rather, we define a new variable called di. What is di? Di is the difference between yi and xi. Now, we are transforming our two information about the same person into just one single information, which is the difference between them. Okay? It's these are pairs, that's why they call it paired samples. They are all connected to each other. It is dependent between them. So therefore we define a new variable di, which is the difference between xi and yi. This is called the individual change in test score. In test score. Okay? Remark. The first device is xi and yi are not independent. That's what I was saying. Are not independent. This is very important. They are not independent. Okay? The second thing is di can be regarded as a simple sample or single sample. As a single sample. So since it can be regarded as a single sample, then you have only one confidence interval for one mean, because you have to find the mean of di, the variance of di, and so on and so forth. Okay? Therefore, the confidence interval, the 100, 1 minus alpha, confidence interval for the mean of D for a paired sample for mu of D, we call it mu of D because now we have transformed our two informations into just one single information, which is different. So we have only one data now instead of two data. So that's why we confidence interval for mu D, which is different between the samples. Will be given by d bar, which is the mean of d, right, plus or minus d alpha over 2 n minus 1 degrees of freedom times the standard deviation of d divided by n. And this is for what? For what? Thank you. For n greater than 3. I should be the opposite side because I'm using t. So it should be n below 10. Because I'm using t. So for n less than 30. And we have the same thing, d bar plus or minus z alpha over 2 n minus 1 is over normal n minus 1. SD over root n for n bigger than 3. Okay? So that's what we have. An example of that example, we have a student 1, 2, 3, 4. And then we have